Okay. Let's go with candidiasis. 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 Guys, candidiasis is a fungus. It can be anywhere in the body. General rule. Aggressive candidiasis, think about immunocompromised state. Now, when I say that, it doesn't mean HIV, which it could be. Think diabetes. Think diabetes. If you got an adult with bad oral candidiasis or vaginal candidiasis, just check a blood sugar. I got a quick question for you. Quick question for you. What random blood glucose, if the person's thirsty, what random blood glucose says they're a diabetic? What random blood glucose says, ooh, this one's a diabetic. This one's a diabetic. Alina is exactly correct, ma'am. 200. If they're over 200 and they're thirsty or peeing a lot, remember, what is the four diagnostic criteria for diabetes? The mnemonic is R2F3. Not a great mnemonic, but I think of it as a robot like R2D2. It's R2F3. How do I diagnose diabetes? Random blood glucose of greater than 200 plus symptoms. Two is a 2-hour glucose tolerance test. That is normally not done unless they're pregnant. R2F, what does F mean? F is a fasting blood glucose of greater than 126 times two, which basically means we got to check out on two separate days. I don't buy one reading. And then what does the three mean? The three equals an HbA1c, and that's greater than 6.5. Okay. How do I diagnose diabetes? Random 2-hour glucose tolerance test, fasting, hemoglobin A1c. So, candidiasis or tinny infections. They love warm and moist places like the vagina, like panises and skin folds, okay, and the groin. Love sugar. Diabetics love to get candidiasis infections. They love to gang out of muscle out of the organism, so it's opportunistic. And potassium hydroxide. If you have some infection that you're concerned could be tinea, remember we scrape it. If we put potassium hydroxide on it, look under the microscope, we should see spaghetti and meatballs or hyphae and buds. Okay. Now, here's the hyphae and buds that you'd see under the microscope. So potassium hydroxide prep helps us to diagnose. Ooh, quick question, quick question. Potassium hydroxide helps me to diagnose candidiasis. Ooh, what other disease, what other infection does potassium hydroxide help me diagnose? Ooh, what's that? Ooh, what other infection does potassium hydroxide help me with? What do you think? It is BV, bacterial vaginosis, also known as Gardnerella. Bacterial vaginosis. Please remember, if you have a woman who has bacterial vaginosis, you get some vaginal secretion, put potassium hydroxide on it. It gives that whiff test, that amine test. So potassium hydroxide, candidiasis, bacterial vaginosis. Okay. Now, candidiasis can affect the body in multiple areas. Tinea capitis is just dandruff. Tinea corporis is wingworm. Tinea curis is jock itch. Tinea unguium gives you pits on the fingers, and it could be tinea pedis. Tinea pedis is fungus on the feet. Now, I heard an infectious disease doc talk one time about someone getting tinea pedis, athlete's foot. And he's like, why do some people get it and some people don't? Guys, it really doesn't matter if you walk with shower shoes or not. It's more about some people just lack an enzyme on their skin that fights it off. Okay. I will give you a warning right now, or a pro tip at least. When someone's getting lower extremity cellulitis, the port of entry is normally tinea pedis. Just keep that in mind. Okay. So if someone's getting frequent cellulitises, maybe treat them for tinea. Look at their feet, make sure they don't have tinea infections, and treat them for that. That may decrease the port of entry. Okay. Now, tinea is typically red. Well defined. Now, time out, time out, time out. Any skin infection that's superficial, it's very well demarcated. So, the two skin infections that are well demarcated are candidiasis and strep. Strep is impetigo, okay? Cellulitis is deep. Cellulitis is deep. Cellulitis is staph. So, cellulitis normally does not have very crisp borders. Strep does. So, strep makes me think about impetigo and erysipelas. Well demarcated. Candidiasis is well demarcated. They have pustules, papules, vesicles, and scales. Pustules are like pimples with pus in it. Papules are raised bumps. Vesicles are fluid-filled bumps, and scales speak for themselves. If you look down here, Very well demarcated, guys. Very well demarcated. And these are these satellite lesions. Okay. So this right here is a classic picture. Now, to me, like if my kid came back from daycare with this, I'd think, boy, I think someone bit my kid. Kind of looks like that, but it wouldn't be scaly. This is ringworm, also known as tinea corporis. Okay, tinea corporis. So thrush in the mouth. Basically, when someone has thrush, they'll have whitish plaques. Please remember, guys, it happens in kids, no big deal. If it happens in adult, go, why the hell is an adult getting thrush? Check a blood sugar. Maybe I'm checking for HIV. When you scrape the thrush off, it will scrape. Underneath it, the base will be red. Okay, they'll have an erythematous base. Potassium hydroxide and nystatin, swish and swallow or swish and spit, will help cure this. Asthma, look at what Anna put. I love that. And that's exactly right. And I didn't even think about it, but Anna's absolutely right. If someone is using asthma inhalers, especially if it's steroids, okay, inhaled steroids, that will kind of make your mouth immunocompromised and therefore thrush. Love that. And I appreciate that input. That's exactly right. Now, if you look at someone's fingers and you see these little divots, now the pits are psoriasis, okay? But oftentimes, tinea can kind of fool you. So when someone's got real flaky looking, boy, I think that's probably tinea unguium. And guys, when you treat that, it's oral and it's a prolonged course, okay? It could be psoriasis. So tinea unguium, fungal infection of the toes and the fingers. They typically have these thick toes, yellowish discoloration, okay? And it's prolonged antifungal course, typically months. Now, how do we treat fingernail infections with funguses? Well, oral antifungals are preferred due to the high rates of cure, but they have systemic effects. I'm sorry, but they have systemic adverse effects and a lot of drug-to-drug interactions. Terbinafine times 6 weeks for fingernails, 12 weeks for toenails. So there's some other ones as well, some other azoles. So just make sure it's within your wheelhouse. And when you prescribe it, you just may want to talk to a pharmacist. Hey, I know there's a lot of drug interactions. Can we just look this over, make sure this is good with this patient? Now, as a pro tip right now, if a pharmacist calls you and says, hey, just so you know, you put this patient on a medicine and they're on this medicine and this medicine, and that may cause a prolonged QT syndrome. My recommendation is just don't accept it. Like, don't take that risk on. It's probably nothing. Almost, I just say, what do you recommend? What could we switch it to? Help me understand. What could we switch it to? And quite frankly, I'm never going to say, it would be incredibly rare for me to say, I'm going to accept that potentially lethal risk of an arrhythmia. So I would just talk to them, say, help me navigate that. Okay. Okay. Now, if you look here, if you have someone who's got abnormal plaques of discoloration, that's tinea vesicolor, still a fungal infection, tinea vesicolor, okay? Tinea vesicolor, that is from a fungus, which the board seemed to love this. At least the old boards did. Just so you guys know, on the panery, I have not seen them ask really silly academic questions. And you know what? Who's this a credit to? The CEO of the NCCPA, Dawn Morton-Rios. When she took over and I met with her, she basically said, I'm getting clinical test raters for the PANRI. I want clinicians to test clinicians. And thank God it's not academics, okay? I get really frustrated when I have an academic who hasn't been in the trenches doing what I did, trying to test me, and you haven't seen a patient in 30 years. That's not what it is now. They have clinical test raters. So I don't believe they'll ask about Malayasi furfur. Now, with tinea, think about varied colors. Tinea, there are very different colors. So it's either hypo or hyperpigmentations that coalesce their macules, possibly patches on the trunk or upper back. So let me go back. Look here. There's very many colors here. You're looking for the discoloration. That's tinea vesicolor. There's varied colors. It could be hypo or hyper, depending on the pigment of the adult. It's more common in summer. Now, the diagnosis is if you get in there, try to scrape some off and do potassium hydroxide. Biopsy is definitive. Now, just so you know, sometimes a Woods lamp, like you look at for fluorescein stain, can transilluminate, can transilluminate, can transilluminate, can be. Now, whoever gets the one right, I'm going to think is, whoever gets the one right, here's my question for you. You got your woods lamp in your hand. Now, someone comes in with an overdose. They overdosed on something. You don't know what it is. But you take the woods lamp and you hold it up to the urine, and the urine glows. What overdose glows with a woods lamp? I'll give you a hint. It's the most common poison used on forensic files. No. I love forensic files, by the way. It is ethylene glycol, ethylene glycol, antifreeze, ethylene glycol is antifreeze. Just so you guys know, I think it's not used as much anymore, but why do they make, they kind of did it on purpose. Why would ethylene glycol transilluminate in a woods lamp? Because in the old vehicles, when they had radiators, if the radiator was leaking, it'd leak antifreeze. So guess what? You could hold the woods lamp up and see where it's leaking from. Okay. All right. All of this. Hold on, guys. Wait a second. Let's just appreciate something tonight. I talked to you about malaria therapy, just good trivia, right? Hold on. I talked to you about Campylobacter being diagnosed by that physician drinking it. But more importantly, what I sang you a nursery rhyme about posies. Okay. I'm bringing some pretty good game tonight, I think. Woods lamp. John, help us with the pants funny guy. We don't need your medical trivia. You listen, we're here because of Pan Real A, and I don't want to hear one more historical fact about like lobotomies. Guys, I just finished 3 days of board review course, so I've been kind of a little slappy. But the good news is I'm not falling asleep on you. That's the good news. Okay. We've been there before. Okay, titty vesicular. How do we treat it? Topicals. Topicals work just fine. Selenium sulfide. Guys, that's like Celsin Blue. Some of the azoles, these are antifungals. Benzoyl peroxide. And if it's systemic, then we use ketoconazole, etraconazole. But bottom line is, how do we treat titty vesicolor? Topicals. Now, Neisseria. Now, we're going to talk about Neisseria and chlamydia. Neisseria and chlamydia. So when I talk about a sexually transmitted infection, we're talking about gonorrhea, chlamydia, but also we got to think syphilis. We got to think HIV. We got to think like herpes virus. Right now we're talking about gonorrhea, gonorrhea and chlamydia. Ladies and gentlemen, gonorrhea is a pretty nasty genital urinary infection. So gonorrhea is a gram negative diplococci. If I say to you gram negative diplococci, I'm saying Neisseria. If I said to you a gram positive diplococci, I'm saying strep pneumoniae. Watch me. Right here, gram-negative diplococci is Neisseria. Gram-positive diplococci is strep pneumoniae. So Neisseria causes two major diseases. It causes meningitis and it causes gonorrhea. Okay. Now, Neisseria meningitis is a very, very, very bad meningitis where if you take every patient who's got Neisseria meningitis, close contacts are going to be treated. So if you take care of a patient in your office or in the ER, and they end up having Neisseria meningitis, the health department is going to contact you and they're going to put you on Cipro. Okay. Please remember, what other infectious disease demands close contacts are treated? Pertussis. So Neisseria meningitis, you're going on Cipro. If it's pertussis, you're going on a macrolide like azithromycin or erythromycin. Okay. Now, meningitis is Neisseria gonorrhea. Gonorrhea is a sexually transmitted infection, as we know. So anybody with meningitis, we're thinking strep pneumoniae or Neisseria meningitis. Now, meningitis, the germ, I don't think this is super important, guys. Anybody can get meningitis. It can be from a newborn baby, infants and children, to adults, to older adults. The bottom line is, if we say meningitis, we have to think about the diplococci, Neisseria and strep pneumoniae. Guys, how do we kill it? 2 grams of ceftriaxone, 1 gram of vanco. That should be our go-to meningitis cocktail. 2 grams ceftriaxone, 1 gram of vanco. Okay. Now, warning. If you see a patient who your gut says, man, I think this guy's got meningitis. I think that, wait, what's going to make me think someone's got meningitis? If I walk into someone's room and they go like this, and if they turn their torso to look at me and they didn't turn their neck, that ain't normal. Okay. Please remember, guys, as soon as you go, oh shit, I think they got meningitis, you got 1 hour to give them antibiotics. As soon as you go, oh shit, you got 1 hour. Now, if you cannot get an LP within 1 hour, draw blood cultures and give me antibiotics right now. Do not delay. Do not call your supervising doc. Do not call an emergency room. If you think they get meningitis and you know it is absolutely impossible for me to get an LP within an hour and then get antibiotics on board, squirt them right now. Do not delay. Ladies and gentlemen, there's a reasonable chance that someone with bacterial meningitis, they're going to die no matter what. If you delay antibiotics and they die, you may be held accountable for it. If you only would have given antibiotics, they would have lived. So you could be opening yourself up to a massive lawsuit. And guys, be aware of something. When you get served with legal papers, for the lawsuit to conclude, it normally takes about 2 years. So just know when you get into a legal battle, you get a certified letter, you're going to have a very uncomfortable 2 years. You have two Christmases, that's very uncomfortable, okay? So if it's a newborn baby, the germs are typically genitourinary. Mom is always cultured at 36 weeks of pregnancy to see if there's strep in the vagina. If so, treat mom, okay? E. coli, genitourinary, listeria. Bottom line is kids, we're going to think about H flu. Adults, we think listeria, monocyte sogenes. The bottom line is vanco and ceftriaxone are the mainstays. Now, if you have someone with a fever and petechial lesions, you know they're petechial because you push on it, they don't blanch. If you hold a glass jar to it, you can see the lesions be underneath. That's very sinister for Neisseria meningitis. Okay. Raj, good to see you, brother. See you next week, my friend. Good to see you. Okay. Gonorrhea, guys. When someone has a genitourinary infection, so when someone has gonorrhea, just know it's typically a thick, more aggressive, it's much more aggressive than chlamydia. Okay. So incubation period is 2 to 8 days. So if a guy gets exposed to gonorrhea on Monday, anywhere from Tuesday to next Monday, they're going to get the genitourinary infection. It may go to deeper genitourinary infections like prostatitis or epididymitis. It's possible. Now, anytime there's a sexually transmitted infection and oral sex is involved, the germ can affect the mucous membranes of the eye or the mouth. So you get conjunctivitis or a pharyngitis. How do I kill gonorrhea? One shot, 500 milligram ceftriaxone. Now, time out. Gram-negative diplococci, I kill with ceftriaxone. If it's in meningitis, I give them 2 grams. If it's gonorrhea, 500 milligrams. Okay? Just always be aware, guys. HIV and syphilis kind of go with this risk pool. Now, how do I test for gonorrhea? Bottom line is we're going to do nucleic acid amplification testing. Guys, we're going to test. We're going to do a pelvic exam, do some cultures, vagina, and the male urethra, and they may just check their urine. We can check in the urine now. Always check for gonorrhea and chlamydia at the same time. And if a guy or girl comes in with a sexually transmitted infection, we're going to treat for both. Okay. We won't know what it is right away because the cultures don't come back. Hey guys, I got to ask you a question. And this is something I was ignorant to. I did not know this until about 2 weeks ago. I got a question based on the state that you're practicing in. If a patient comes in and you're very concerned they have gonorrhea or chlamydia, here's my question for you. Are you allowed to write prescriptions for antibiotics for their partner? Are you allowed to do that in your state? Do you even know? Do you know? I can tell you this right now. I was unaware of that. I didn't think you could, but I did talk to one of the representatives from the North Carolina Academy of Physician Assistants. And he said they have a law in place that you can write a prescription for a patient's partner in North Carolina. I was like, I didn't know that. So just be aware that may be available in your state too. Obviously, from what I understand, a bunch of us online right now are not necessarily doing sexually transmitted infections. But just know, I thought You could not write a prescription for somebody if you didn't see them. I know in North Carolina, there's an exception if it's a sex transmitted infection. So keep that in mind. Matter of fact, I may research that just because now I'm curious, what states can you do that in? Keep that in mind. So how do I kill a patient with a, if someone's got a sexually transmitted infection, I mean, ceftriaxone 500 milligrams and doxycycline 100 BID for 7 days, and that will kill chlamydia, okay? In Florida, we cannot. Okay, Sharon, I thank you. I appreciate that. Ms. Sharon, what part of Florida are you from?
Miami.
Got you. I appreciate it. Are you familiar? Are you aware that I'm from St. Pete?
Oh, no, I didn't know that. Look, oh, okay.
We're like almost neighbors.
Yes.
We normally have to dodge the same hurricane path.
I know. And there's one out there right now.
That's what I hear. All right. Chlamydia trachomatis. Chlamydia trachomatis, guys. Chlamydia is a less aggressive sexually transmitted infection. So it's a leading cause of infertility because, guys, when a female gets chlamydia or gonorrhea, it fries their fallopian tubes. It scars them. And when it scars them, they either get ectopic pregnancies or infertility. So, ladies and gentlemen, when someone has pelvic inflammatory disease, we got to admit them. We got to give them IV antibiotics and try to heal this the best they can to prevent ectopics and infertility. So it's considered a silent epidemic because about 60% of people can be asymptomatic, okay? Now, the symptoms of chlamydia are less impressive than gonorrhea. Very similar to a urinary tract infection, I use a mnemonic, DERF, and I don't think it's a great mnemonic, but it helps me. What are the four general urinary symptoms? Dysuria, urgency, retention, frequency. Dysuria, urgency, retention, and frequency. So vaginal bleeding and discharge, abdominal pain, painful sexual intercourse, fever, or dyspareunia. So chlamydia trachomatis, it's also known as non-gonococcal urethritis, but guys, hold on. They better not ask that. They better not ask that. Remember, if someone has a urethral discharge, you do a gram stain, and it's got gonorrhea. Gonorrhea is gram-negative diplococci. So if you have gram-negative diplococci, we're going to say you have gonococcal urethritis. And if you do a gram stain and there's nothing there, well, that's chlamydia, because chlamydia doesn't stain. That's called a non-gonococcal urethritis. They should not ask that, okay? So a bunch of different ways we can test for it. We kill this with doxycycline. Now, just be aware, guys, we used to kill this with 1 gram of azithromycin. Now, what was the advantage of that? Compliance was 100%. So why did we go to doxy? Well, doxy is more thorough, and people were getting kind of, you know, resistant to the azithromycin. I would say this. Let's just say it's someone who came in and they have a sexually transmitted infection, and maybe they're homeless, maybe they're commercial sex worker. I was warned at the conference I'm at right now, I used the word prostitute, and they said that's not the right term. It's a commercial sex worker. Oh, okay. But let's just say you're concerned that they won't come back. You're concerned, though, that they won't even get the script filled for the doxy. What I would recommend doing is give them 500 of Rocephin times one. Give them a gram of azithromycin. Just give it to them. Now, in the old days, that was curative, and prescribe the doxycycline. So if they're non-compliant with the doxy, at least you got them with the azithro. It's better than nothing, okay? Because, guys, we don't want them walking around with chlamydia, not only spreading it to other people, but it's going to fry their fallopian tubes, okay? So if you have a sexually transmitted disease, chlamydia, gonorrhea, remember, doxy 100 milligrams BID for 7 days, ceftriaxone 500 milligrams times one. Cool. Last slide. If you have a female who's got PID, timeout. I love making this analogy. I know you've heard it from me before, but I want to make sure we're crystal clear on this. Okay, what's the difference between a cystitis and a UTI? Nothing. Same thing. Same exact thing. What's the difference between a cystitis and a urethritis? Big difference. Big difference. Cystitis is E. coli. Urethritis is gonorrhea, chlamydia. Now, a urethritis is in a dude. Women don't get urethritis. Women get cervicitis. So guys get urethritis. Females get cervicitis. Cool. So if you have a cervicitis, we're thinking gonorrhea, chlamydia. When you do a pelvic exam, you see mucopurulent discharge. Now, Please remember, cystitis is due to a pylo. What cervicitis is the PID, meaning that we have superficial infections and deep infections. Guys, when someone has a UTI, they should not have a fever. When someone has a cervicitis, I mean, they'll have chandelier sign. It will hurt them. They shouldn't have fevers. If you have someone who's got cervicitis or cystitis with fever, pylo or PID, and those people you have to think about admitting. PID has to come in. They got to be admitted for IV antibiotics. Pylos, you better think about admitting them because they can get pretty sick. But if you hit them, aggressive fluids and antibiotics, they could recover right well. Now, if you have someone with PID, they can get these strings, adhesions attached to the front of the liver, the abdominal wall. We call that Fitzhugh-Curtis syndrome. Fitzhugh-Curtis syndrome. That is a perihepatitis that is a sequelae post-PID. Right upper quadrant pain with a pleuritic component may go to the right shoulder, and you might even think it's cholecystitis. Now, the liver functions are normal, and these are these violin string adhesions that happens after PID.